طيب، إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، we have seen some chapters in the life of Imam Ahmad رحمه الله, Imam Sunnah. And what we saw was actually just a small peek into his life, just a small one. And really, I agree with the statement of the Shaykh when he said, إِذَا رَأَيْتَ رَجُلًا يُحِبُّ أَحْمَدًا فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ صَاحِبُ سُنَّةٍ. If you see an individual and he loves Imam Ahmad, know that he is a companion of the Sunnah. We're going to move a little bit closer to the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, we're going to look at something of the life of Al-Imam Al-Hafidh Abi Abdullah Muhammad ibn Idris ibn Abbas ibn Uthman ibn Shafi' Al-Qurashi ثم المطلبي الشافعي المكي الغزي المولد from Philistine. Shafi'i is from Palestine. Who was born 150 years after the Hijra. This is the year that Abu Hanifa passed away. And he died 204. Imam Ahmad, Imam Ahmad, that was a slip of the tongue. Imam Shafi'i actually was raised as an orphan under the care of his mother also. And she feared for him and his upbringing. And so she moved back to the place out of Palestine, to the place of the origin of his family, which was Mecca. He was only 2 years at the time. Imam Shafi'i started out his youth by learning archery, and he became very proficient. So much so that out of 10 tribes, he would hit 9 all bullseye. It was very good. That's excellent. Okay. After that, he became very interested in the Arabic language and also poetry. And hopefully we'll see some of his poetry, inshallah, before we end and conclude this sitting. Then the science of fiqh and hadith became dear to him, and he actually became very outstanding in this area. Al-Shafi'i, he speaks about himself, speaking about the bounties and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to him. He said, I memorized the Quran at the age of 7. He also memorized the Muwatta at a very young age, tender age. That's the Muwatta, all of it. Okay? Al-Rabi'i, he said, I heard Al-Shafi'i saying, I came to Malik, rahimahullah, waqad hafiztu al-Muwatta, zahira. I came to Imam Malik in Medina and had already memorized the Muwatta by heart. Okay? So I said to Imam Malik, قُلْتُ أُرِيدُ سَمَاعَهُ, I would like to hear it from you. He said, seek someone who would recite it or read it for you. I said, no problem, why don't you listen to my reading of it? Imam Al-Shafi'i was very constant in his reading of the Quran, and actually his recitation used to be very fast for purposes of retention and tafkir. He used to actually, on a daily basis, conclude the Quran from Fatiha to Nas. Okay? So on a daily basis. And in Ramadan, he would do this twice a day. So he was kind of involved in the recitation of the Quran. Okay? Normally, the Prophet ﷺ suggested that you don't recite it in less than 3 days. But one of the things that the Ahlul Ilm, like Nawawi in his Tibyan, the Adab Hamalat al-Quran, pointed out that the recommendations that we found in the Sunnah should be adhered to. And the people differ, and this is why we find from amongst the A'imma from the time of the Sahaba that they had different practices. Not because that they went against the Sunnah, but because they understood it to mean or to understood the Sunnah in a certain way. And so for purposes of recall and retention, and because of their ability to reflect on it, they had different practices. As far as Imam Ash-Shafi'i's sincerity, he used to say, وَدِدْتُ أَنَّ النَّاسِ تَعَلَّمُ هَذَا الْعِلْمِ وَلَا يُنْسَبْ إِلَيْهِ شَيْءٌ مِّنْهُ أَبَدًا. I wish that the people would acquire this knowledge and that nothing of it would be attributed to me. فَأُجَرْ عَلَيْهِ. And that I would receive the reward for it and no one would praise me. Imam Ash-Shafi'i, a person once said to him, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then he said, أتأخذ به? Are you going to act upon it? So Imam Ash-Shafi'i says, أرأيت أني خرجت من كنيسة? He said, it looked like I came out of a church to you. وعلي زنار, or I'm a fire worshiper wearing this waistband. He says, حتى إذا سمعت عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حديثا لا أقول به. So much so that if I hear something from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, I'm not going to say it and act upon it. According to Imam Shafi'i, he said, أجمع المسلمون على من استبان له سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يحل له أن يدعها لقول أحد. Imam Shafi'i said, it is agreed upon by the scholars. The Muslims have agreed upon this. That once the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam has become clear to the people, it is not lawful for anyone to give it up and put it aside for the statement of any other human being. Abu Thawr said, I heard him saying, each hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فُوَ قَوْلِي. This is my statement and my position. وَإِن لَمْ تَسْمَعُوهُ مِنِّي. Even if you don't hear it from me. If Allah's Messenger said it, then I'm upon what Allah's Messenger said. Imam Shafi'i used to encourage the people. He used to say, عَلَيْكُمْ بِأَصْحَابِ الْحَدِيثِ. Stick to the people of the hadith. عَلَيْكُمْ بِأَصْحَابِ الْحَدِيثِ فَإِنَّهُمْ أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ صَوَابًا. Because they are the people that you will find closest to the truth. قال, he said, إذا رأيت رجلا من أصحاب الحديث فكأنما رأيت رجلا من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, when you see a man of the hadith, it's as if you're looking at a companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. جزاهم الله خيرا حفظوا لنا الأصل فلهم علينا الفضل. He said, may Allah reward them, they protected and preserved for us the foundation of the deen, so they have a right over us. Imam Shafi'i, because of his love for hadith and hadith science, he used to say, كُلُّ الْعُلُومِ سِوَى الْقُرْآنِ مَشْغَلَ. All of those other things and preoccupations is nothing but a distraction. إِلَّا الْحَدِيثِ وَإِلَّا الْفِقْهُ فِي الدِّينِ. Except the hadith and understanding Allah's deen. العلم ما كان فيه قال حدثنا. Knowledge, true knowledge, is when a person says حدثنا. He comes with the chain from himself to Allah's Messenger. وما سوى ذاك وسواس الشياطين. And what is other than that is nothing but a whisper from the devil. If it has no basis in the deen, and you cannot quote the Qur'an and sunnah, and you're putting in Allah's deen something, it's not from Allah, it's from the devil. Ahmad ibn Abbas, al-Nasa'i, he said, I heard Ahmad ibn Hanbal so many times I cannot count them. وَهُوَ يَقُولُ He was saying, قَالَ أَبُو عَبْدِ اللَّهِ الشَّافِعِي That him, الشَّافِعِي, Abu Abdullah al-Shafi'i said, Then he would say, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَتْبَعَ لِلْأَثَرِ مِنَ الشَّافِعِي I've seen no one more strict in following the way of the Prophet ﷺ than a Shafi'i. Shafi'i disliked polemics and that you argue and dispute about things of the deen. He says, حُكْمِي فِي أَهْلِ الْكَلَامِ حُكْمُ عُمَرَ فِي صَبِيغِ My judgment in respect to these people is like the judgment of Umar in Sabir. Sabir ibn Isl al-Handali. He came to Medina and he started disputing with the people and trying to introduce some doubts in their deen. So Umar got some branch leaves from the date palm, some date palms, and he made a little implement with it. And then he called Sabir, he said, come here. And he continued to have an affair with him until the brother said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, قَدْ ذَهَبَ الَّذِي كُنْتُ أَجِدُهُ فِي رَأْسِي He said, Oh Amir al-Mu'mineen, what I used to find in my head is all gone now. Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, we have a narration here from Abu Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hatim. He says that Yunus ibn Abd al-A'la said, I heard Abu Abdullah al-Shafi'i, and he was questioned about Allah's qualities and his attributes. وَمَا يُؤْمِن بِهِ And he said, لِلَّهِ أَسْمَى وَصِفَاتٍ Allah has names and he has attributes. جَاءَ بِهَا كِتَابُهُ وَأَخْبَرَ بِهَا نَبِيُّهُ His book. They're found in his book and his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, came with it. And he informed his prophet, sorry, his nation, about them. لا يسأ حد قامت عليه حجة ردها It's not becoming for anyone who receives the evidence to refuse what Allah and his messenger gave us. لأن القرآن نزل بها The Quran was revealed with these things. وصح عن الرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم القول بها and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم we know from authentic sources that he spoke concerning these things فإن خالف ذلك بعض ثبوت الحجة عليه فهو كافر whoever rejects these things of the Quran and the Sunnah after the evidences have been presented to him this person is outside of Islam He says, فَأَمَّا قَبْلَ ثَبُوتِ الْحُجِّ فَمَعْذُورٌ بِالْجَهَلِ As for the person who has not yet been informed about it, he has an excuse because of his ignorance. He says, لِأَنَّ عِلْمَ ذَلِكَ لَا يُدْرَكْ بِالْعَقْلِ وَلَا بِالرَّوِيَّ وَلَا الْفِكْرِ Because the knowledge of these things cannot be had through the intellect, nor through reflection or thought. وَلَا نُكَثَّرُ بِالْجَهْلِ بِهَا أَحَدًا And we do not say that anyone is outside of Islam because of his ignorance about these things. إِلَّا بَعْضِ انْتِهَاءِ الْخَبْرِ إِلَيْهِ بِهَا Until he is informed. And he recognizes that this is something that Allah said or the Prophet ﷺ taught. He says, وَنُثْبِتْ هَذِي الصِّفَاتِ وَنَنْفِي عَنْهَا التَّشْبِيهِ كَمَا نَفَاهُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ فَقَالَ لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ He said, and we affirm all of the qualities that we find in the Qur'an and in the Sunnah about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we refuse to liken him to his creation the way Allah has negated this from himself when he said there is nothing whatsoever like him, yet he is the all-hearing, the all-seeing. In this particular statement of Imam al-Shafi'i, he was telling you the basis or the foundation of the belief that the people of old had in respect to looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and reviewing his names and attributes. You accept them as they appear in the Quran and the Sunnah, and you do not explain them away to mean something other than their apparent meaning. This is important because people differed in later generations concerning this. Okay? Imam Shafi, he said, the statement in respect to the Sunnah, and we need to know that the Sunnah, when used by the earliest scholars, it had many different meanings. Sometimes the word Sunnah referred to what the Prophet ﷺ commanded to be done, whether it was through his statement, alright, or by some indication, or any Sunnah that has a legal intent behind it. Sometimes the word Sunnah is equivalent to Hadith. Sometimes the word Sunnah refers to whatever we have from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, words, deeds, what he acknowledges, what he deliberately left alone, and his characteristics. All of those things are sometimes included in the Sunnah. Sometimes the word Sunnah is used and it specifically refers to your belief system. Like Imam Ahmad, his son has a book, it's called Kitabu Sunnah. What it means is Kitabu al-I'tiqad, or a book of belief. Imam Shafi'i says, the statement in respect to the Sunnah, on a belief system, that I'm upon, and I found the people before me upon, وَرَأَيْتُ عَلَيْهَا الَّذِينَ رَأَيْتُهُمْ, and I saw the people before me adhering to this, مِثْلَ Sufyan, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, وَمَالِك, Imam Malik ibn Anas, and others, al-iqrar bi-shahada an la ilaha illallah, to acknowledge that there is nothing worthy of worship other than Allah. Sometimes this particular shahada is translated as there is no God but Allah. That is a wrong translation. Okay? The correct translation is there is nothing worthy of worship other than Allah. Allah mentions in the Quran that people have a lot of gods that they worship. But none deserves to be worshipped in truth, or rightfully deserves to be worshipped other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, he goes on and he says, وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then he says, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى عَرْشِهِ فِي سَمَائِهِ يعني فوق سمائه. That Allah is above his throne, above the sky. يَقْرُبْ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ كَيْفَ يَشَاءُ وَيَنْزِلُ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ الدُّنْيَا كَيْفَ يَشَاءُ. He comes close to his servant the way he wills, and he descends the way he wills. Here, actually, Imam al-Shafi'i, when he made this statement, he was making a statement because there had appeared in the Muslim community a group of individuals who thought that you could not attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what they call af'al al-ikhtiyariya, things that he does by choice. Okay? Descending, speaking, and all of those things. So they denied it. Or they interpreted in a way that it was no longer applicable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or lost its meaning. So Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik, Sufyan al-Thawri, Layth ibn Sa'd, okay, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, and all of the a'imma dealt with these particular issues for the protection of our aqidah, our belief system. Okay? And actually, that way of thinking was introduced by a person called Jaham ibn Safwan. He was the one who introduced this. And unfortunately, that way of thinking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is even inside of us, has become more popular than the way the Sahaba and the A'imma, the Imams of the Tabi'een, used to believe. So much so that if you sit in a sitting and you read certain books, you hear a person says, "An al-haq, I am the truth. Ma fi jubbati illa Allah, nothing in this jabe or in this particular garment other than Allah. In other words, I am an expression of Allah." That way of belief was introduced into the Muslim community. It was not there before. And for this reason, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik, and Imam Ahmad, when you look into their belief system, they make it clear that this is not the way the Sahaba believe or the A'imma from among the Tabi'een, even though it is popular in many books. Okay? also in respect to Imam, Imam al-Shafi'i, and we're touching on some of these areas for Imam al-Shafi'i and also Imam al-Malik, because in our next sitting, inshallah, I don't think we'll have time to cover all the areas. Imam al-Shafi'i had a belief along with Imam Ahmed, along with Imam Malik and all of the others. And if you hear me get mixed up with Imam Ahmed and Imam al-Shafi'i, somebody just indicate that we just got through with Imam Ahmed. Okay? And pardon me if I do that. He said, they all believe that Iman was the conviction in the heart, along with the statement of the tongue and actions that you do with your limbs. Okay? Actions that you do with your limbs. The actions are a part of that. According to Jahm ibn Safwan, he says, no. Iman huwa al-ma'rifah. Iman is just knowing. Having awareness in your heart and knowing. So according to this person, Fir'aun, Pharaoh was a mu'min, was a believer. Not even Pharaoh, Iblis, according to him, was a believer. Because he knew that Allah was his Lord and his Creator. Of course, that way of thinking is wrong, and we know that. Okay? Some people thought that it is sufficient, based on that statement, to have it in your heart. You say, I'm a believer, it's in my heart. And I'm all right with Allah down here. Don't worry about praying and all that. That's not necessary. I believe in my heart. That goes against the definition of Iman by the Prophet ﷺ himself. We find in the narration collected by both Bukhari and Muslim, that the Prophet ﷺ said to the delegation of Abd Qais, he questioned them, do you know what Iman is? They said, Allah and His Messenger know best. He said, Iman, this is Allah's messenger, the Prophet ﷺ defining faith for the believers. He said, Iman is that you bear witness that there is nothing, no God is worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that Muhammad ﷺ is the messenger of Allah. That you establish salah. That you establish salah. That you pray. That you give zakah. That you fast in Ramadan, that you give a fifth out of the spoils of al-fay al-ghanima. Here the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that salah is a part of iman, that's action. Giving zakah is a part of iman, that's also action. To fast in Ramadan is a part of, this is from Allah's messenger. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He here defines for the believer what Iman is, what faith is. However, we sometimes see that when Iman, and this is because of an analysis of the hadith that the Ahlul Ilm or the people of knowledge have this position, that sometimes Iman is mentioned together with Islam. Like in the hadith, the famous hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab, the hadith of Jibreel. And the Prophet ﷺ was questioned, what is Islam? And he expressed the outward actions along with the shahada. And he was asked about Iman. And he responded to believe in Allah, his angels, his books, his messengers, the last day and at the end of the hadith. Whenever they come together like that, in a paragraph, both are mentioned. Normally Islam refers to what you do outwardly, and Iman refers to what is in your belief system and what you have in your heart. However, when used individually, one implies the other. That is why when we have here, as is found in this hadith of Ibn Abbas, which was collected by both Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ spoke about Iman and he included aspects of Islam. We also know that actions are a part of faith because of the hadith of Abi Huraira, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Iman is more than 70 or 60 parts. The highest being the expression, La ilaha illallah, The lowest is moving something harmful from the pathway, and modesty is a part of faith. Moving something, that's action. Here Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once again instructs us that actions are a part of faith. According to Imam al-Shafi'i and all of the other imma, like Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad, they mention iman and they say that it increases and it decreases. It increases with obedience and it decreases with disobedience. So you don't feel secure, well, I'm a Muslim, I don't have to obey Allah, but you know, belief is in my heart and I'm guaranteed paradise. If you feel like that, you've been had. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. Allah says, only those truly believe who, when Allah is mentioned, they find a tremor in their hearts. And when His signs are recited to them, they increase in faith and they depend on their Lord. There are many other verses that we have dealing with that particular issue of an increase in iman. Anything that increases, decreases. Anything that has the possibility of increasing, it can decrease. And this is the case of iman. Okay? Here we have a narration from Abi Umama. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, "Man ahabba lillah وأبغض لله وأعطى لله ومنع لله فقد استكمل الإيمان. Whoever loves for Allah's sake, dislikes something for Allah's sake, gives for Allah's sake, prevents for Allah's sake, simply because he is going and moving with the legislation we find in the Quran and Sunnah, this person has completed his faith. Has completed his faith. Many people look at the hadith, and this particular hadith is very popular. Inna Allah, Allah does not look to your bodies and your form, but He looks at what is in your heart. Alright? But they forget that there is another narration for the same hadith, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the same hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that He looks not only to your hearts but also your deeds. And this is also collected by Muslim. The hadith of Abi Huraira, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم said, إن الله لا ينظر إلى صوركم وأموالكم ولكن ينظر إلى قلوبكم وأعمالكم. Allah does not look to your form and your wealth, but He looks to your heart and your deeds. To your heart, what's in your heart, and the deeds that will help you to enter paradise. So much so, you know, you look at some of the verses, like the verse in Surah Al-A'raf, وَنُودُوا أَن تِلْكُمُ الْجَنَّةُ أُورِثْتُمُوهَا بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. And the people will be called out when it's time to enter paradise and say, nay, here is the paradise that you earn because of what you used to do. In the hadith of Abi Dharr al-Ghifari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith al-Qudsi, Ya ibadi, O my servants, innama hiya a'malakum uhsiha lakum thumma uwafikum iyaha. It's only your deeds that I account to and reckon for you. And then you are rewarded accordingly, your deeds. فَمَنْ وَجَدَ خَيْرًا فَلْيَحْمَدِ اللَّهِ. So whoever finds good, let him praise Allah. وَمَنْ وَجِدَ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ فَلَا يَلُومَنَّ إِلَّا نَفْسًا. And if you find other than that, then blame no one but yourself. If you fall short, because you think that is all in your heart, and you have that misguided belief, then blame no one other than yourself when you stand before Allah. According to Imam al-Shafi'i, Al-Rabi' said, I heard a Shafi'i saying, the best of mankind After the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was Abu Bakr, ثم عمر, ثم عثمان, ثم علي. The best was Abu Bakr, then عمر, then عثمان, then علي. Where did Imam Shafi'i get this belief system from? صلى الله عليه وسلم. Where did, from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Okay. Well, actually, it was an acknowledged statement or an acknowledged sunnah, sorry, from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we get that from this narration. Ibn Umar said, we used to choose during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and say, this person is best and this one is best. فَنُخَيِّرْ أَبَا بَكْر. We used to prefer Abu Bakr. Then ثم عمر بن الخطاب, then عمر بن الخطاب, ثم عثمان بن عفان رضي الله عنهم, in that format. In one of the narrations it says this would reach the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he would not criticize it. If it was wrong, he would have corrected it. This is why it is looked at as an acknowledged sunnah. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, okay, this is Ali's son, he said, قلت لأبي, I said to my father, which amongst the people is best after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, Abu Bakr. I said, then who? He said, then Umar. Muhammad ibn Hanafiyya said, I was afraid that he was going to say Uthman, so I said, what about you, Abi? What about you, father? He says, وَمَا أَنَا إِلَّا رَجُلٌ مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. What am I except another man from amongst the Muslims? Everyone agree that Ali ibn Abi Talib is from the Khulafa al-Rashideen. He is from amongst those. Alright? And this statement of his was a statement يعني, done out of modesty and humility. Okay? Abu Thawr says that Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi wrote to al-Shafi'i while he was a young man. He said, I want you to write a book. In this book, I wanted to have the meanings of the Quran, the different disciplines of narration, the proofs of al-ijma' or consensus, the abrogations and the abrogated things from the Quran and Sunnah. So he wrote his book Ar-Risala. Ar-Risala. Al-Muzani, Abu Ibrahim, Ismail ibn Yahya, he said, this was one of the companions of Shafi'i, he said, قرأت كتاب الرسالة للشافعي 500 مرة. He said, I read this book of Shafi'i 500 times. He said, I never knew a time that I picked it up except that I benefited knowledge that I did not receive the first time in its reading. This book of his was something that was very outstanding. Okay? Shafi'i was outstanding in his language. We said earlier that as a young boy he went and he learned the language. All right? And he was a poet also. So much so that Abdul Malik ibn Hisham, everybody knows Ibn Hisham, right? Right? Ibn Hisham, everybody knows him, the one who did the history of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a grammarian. All right? He said, I sat with Shafi'i for long periods of time. He said, فَمَا سَمِعْتُ مِنْهُ لَحْنَةً قَبْ. He said, I never heard him make a grammatical mistake ever. Now see, when you understand the Arabic language, right? You know the regulations are involved. For him to sit down in his classes and lessons and to have this type of impeccable presentation, it tells you something about Shafi'i's language. Okay? So much so he says, شَافِعِي كَلَامُهُ لَوْغَ يُحْتَجُ بِهَا. He says, Shafi'i's speech is of the type of language that you use to determine the correctness or wrongness of something in the language of the Arabs. Shafi'i, because of his outstanding position, Imam Ahmad used to say, مَا بِتُّ مُنْذُ ثَلَاثِينَ سَنَ إِلَّا وَأَنَا أَدْعُ اللَّهَ لِلشَّافِعِي وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ لَهُ. He says, for more than 30 years, I never go to bed, go to sleep, except that I supplicate for Shafi'i and ask Allah to forgive him. Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi, who was one of the fuqaha of the muhaddithin, he said, مَا أُصَلِّ صَلَاةً إِلَّا وَأَنَا أَدْعُ لِلشَّافِي فِيهَا. He says, I never pray the Salah except that I supplicate for a Shafi'i. Shafi'i, some of the poetry that we have from him, Shafi'i said, and this is found in Diwan, he said, دَعِ الْأَيَّامِ تَفْعَلُ مَا تَشَاءُ وَطِبْ نَفْسًا إِذَا حَكَمَ الْقَضَاءُ وَلَا تَجْزَعْ لِحَادِثَةِ اللَّيَالِي فَمَا لِحَوَادِثِ الدُّنْيَا بَقَاءُ وَكُنْ رَجُلًا عَلَى الْأَهْوَالِ جَلْدًا وَشِيمَتُكَ السَّمَاحَةُ وَالْوَفَاءُ وَإِنْ كَثُرَتْ عُيُوبُكَ فِي الْبَرَايَا وَسَرَّكَ أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهَا لَغِطَاءُ يُغَطِّي بِالسَّمَاحَةِ كُلَّ عَيْبٍ وَكَمْ عَيْبٍ يُغَطِّيهَا السَّخَاءُ لا حزن يدوم ولا سرور ولا بؤس عليك ولا رخاء لا تري للأعداء قد ذلا فإن شماتة الأعداء بلاء ولا ترجو سماحة من بخيل فما في النار للظمآن ماء ورزقك ليس ينقصه التأني وليس يزيد في الرزق العناء إذا ما كنت ذا قلب قنوع فأنت ومالك الدنيا سواء من نزلت بساحته المنايا فلا أرض تقيه ولا سماء وأرض الله واسعة ولكن إذا نزل القضاء ضاق الفضاء داء الأيام تقدر كل حين ولا يغني عن الموت دواء رحمه الله. I'll translate it, brothers and sisters. Shafi'i رحمه الله, he used to say, دع الأيام تفعل ما تشاء. Let the days do what they will. وطب نفسا إذا حكم القضاء. And gladden your soul when the decree has passed its judgment. ولا تجزع لحادثة الليالي. And be not unhappy about the occurrences of time. فما لحوادث الدنيا بقاء. For there is no permanence to the episodes of this life. وَكُنْ رَجُلًا عَلَى الْأَهْوَالِ جَلْدًا and be a man strong in times of misfortune. وَشِيمَتُكَ السَّمَاحَةُ وَالْوَفَاءُ and let your character be that of generosity and faithfulness. وَإِنْ كَثُرَتْ عُيُوبُكَ فِي الْبَرَايَا and if your shortcomings become abundant among the people. وَسَرَّكَ أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهَا الْغِطَاءُ and it would please you to have them concealed, يُغَطِي بِالسَّمَاحَةِ كُلَّ عَيْبٍ know that through kindness all faults are covered. وَكَمْ مِنْ عَيْبٍ يُغَطِيهَا السَّخَاءُ and so many shortcomings are covered and concealed through generosity. وَلَا حُزْنٌ يَدُومٌ وَلَا سُرُورٌ no sadness is permanent in this world, nor joy. وَلَا بُؤْسٌ عَلَيْكَ وَلَا رَخَاءٌ neither the suffering when it is upon you, nor the prosperity. لا تري للأعداء قد ذلا. Never display lowliness to the enemy. فإن شماتة الأعداء بلاء. For surely the malice of the foe is truly a test. لا ترجو السماحة من بخيل. Never expect generosity from a mad person. فما في النار للظمآن ماء. For there is in fire no water for the one who thirsts. وَرِزْقُكَ لَيْسَ يُنْقِسَهُ تَأَنِّي your sustenance shall never be decreased through deliberateness. وَلَيْسَ يَزِيدُ فَرِزْقِ الْعَنَاءُ nor shall toil increase your provisions. إِذَا مَا كُنْتَ ذَا قَلْبٍ قَنُوعٍ and if you possess a content heart, فَأَنْتَ وَمَالِكُ الدُّنْيَا سَوَاءُ then you and the king in this world are the same. وَمَنْ نَزْلَ بِسَاحَتِهِ الْمَنَايَا and he in whose courtyard death has alighted. فَلَا أَرْضٌ تَقِيهِ وَلَا سَمَاءُ surely no earth nor sky can protect him. وَأَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةٌ وَلَكِنْ and Allah's earth is spacious. However, إِذَا نَزْلَ الْقَضَاءُ ضَاقَ الْفَضَاءُ once decree descends, the unlimited space narrows. دع الأيام تغدر كل حين. Let the days continue their constant delusions. ولا يغني عن الموت دواء. But know that no cure avails against death. Prepare to meet Allah. Imam al-Shafi'i, رحمه الله, in respect to his Quranic recitation, sometimes the people would come and they would say, we would like to be affected for our hearts to be softened. Let us go إلى هذا الفتى المطلبي. Let us go to this young man and let him read the Quran to us. Say, we would come and he would start recitation of the Quran. And the people would start shedding tears because of the sweetness and tenderness of his voice and the sincerity that he displayed. Once he did this, أمسك عن القراءة من حسن صوته, because of the fineness of his voice. Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah, when it came to discussing fiqh issues, he was very outstanding, very outstanding. Harun ibn Sa'id al-Ayla, he said, if Shafi'i wanted to discuss with you and make you believe that this pillar in the masjid, okay, which is made out of stone, was made out of wood, he would have the ability to do it. He was just given that ability. And Shafi'i also, in spite of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had blessed him with, he was very conscious not to take too much and to be too involved and immersed into this world. Imam Shafi'i or Rabi'i said, the Shafi'i said, for more than 16 years, I never ate to my fill. This was a habit of Imam Shafi'i. Al-Rabi'i said, he explains why Shafi'i was careful not to indulge himself. He said, لِأَنَّ الشِّبْعَ يُثْقِلُ الْبَدْنِ وَيُقَسِّيَ الْقَلْبِ وَيُزِيلَ الْفِطْنَ وَيَجْلِبَ النَّوْمِ وَيَضْعُفْ عَنِ الْعِبَادَةِ. He says, because eating too much, it makes the body heavy. It hardens the heart. It removes the astuteness that a person has, and it produces sleep. And it weakens the person from the acts of ibadah that he intends to do, acts of worship. Imam Shafi'i used to say, Alayka bizuhud. Be austere. Take just what you need of this dunya. Because zuhud in respect to a man is more than, it is more precious and beautiful than the adornment that a young lady wears to adorn herself. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah was a very kind individual. Very kind. He came to Sana'a and they had a tent built for him. Right? And in this tent he had 10,000 dinars. 10,000 gold coins. Before they moved the pillars out of the tent, he had nothing there. Just gave it to the brothers and the sisters and the people who needed. One day Rabi'i said, Tazawajtu. I got married, and Shafi'i asked me, he said, what was the sadaq? What was the mahr? He said, 30 gold coins. I gave her 6 in advance. He said, Fa'atani arba'an wa ishreena. Yani, he gave me the remaining. He gave me 24 gold coins. We're talking about gold coins. Look, we're not talking about quarters, nickels, and dimes. Alright? Imam Shafi'i, Abu Thawr, he was questioned about the fiqh of Shafi'i and that of Muhammad ibn Hassan. Now he said, الشافعي أفقى بن محمد وأبي يوسف وأبي حنيف وحماد وإبراهيم وعلقمة وأسود. This was his position, all right? That he had more understanding than all of them. That was his understanding or his position. Imam Ahmad used to say, Allah places at the head of each century an individual to teach the people the sunnah from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to remove the lies that have been presented into this deen. He said, and we looked at the head of the 100 year and we saw Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Then the second period of time when there was Shafi'i rahimahullah. Imam Shafi'i, he used to say, لَيْسَ إِلَى السَّلَامَ مِنَ النَّاسِ سَبِيلٌ. There's no way to free yourself from the people. You have to mix with the people. فانظر إلى الذي فيه صلاحك فالزمه. Then see, look at him whose companionship benefits and stick to him. Choose your friends. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, as he said, الرجل على دين خليل. The man is on the deen of his friend. Get the people on the sunnah. Befriend them. الشافعي ابن خزيمة said that Muzani said دخلت على الشافعي في مرضه الذي مات فيه. I entered upon Shafi'i in the period of time where he was about to die. And I said to him, Ya Aba Abdullah, كيف أصبحت? How are you doing? How you got it? فرفع رأسه وقال أصبحت من الدنيا راحلا ولإخواني مفارقة ولسوء عملي ملاقيا وعلى الله واردا وما أدري روحي تسير إلى الجنة فأهنيها أو إلى النار فأعزيها ثم بكى رحمه الله. إمام الشافعي on his deathbed and the Muzani came to him. He said, Abu Abdullah, how are you doing? Shafi'i raised his head. He says, I got up this morning about to leave the dunya, about to be separated from my brothers, and about to meet the evil deeds that I sent before, and I'm about to be presented to Allah. I don't know where my soul is going, whether it's going to Jannah so that I may congratulate it, or I'm headed to the fire so I may give it my condolences. And he started to cry. These are some of the things that we quoted from Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah. And I don't think we have a whole lot of time left. Our time is up. We didn't get into the area of Imam Malik rahimahullah. But inshallah, in our next sitting, we'll try to cram it with as much as we can, inshallah, if the brothers and sisters permit. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.